for this concert. We have a rare opportunity today to hear French music of the 19th century and early 20th century with the piano built in the later half of the 19th century. It's a very special piano made by Erard, the most famous piano maker at the time. And this Bill Shaw will talk about the piano later. And also, you know, to find the kind of the sound world that composer might have heard, well, definitely, you know, it's closer to the composer's sound at the time. I put a gut string on my violin so that violin will sound a little different too. The first piece we are going to play is a sonata, early sonata by Maurice Ravel. He was, you know, very famous in his colorful work in later his year, but this one was when he was 22 years old. It's published as opus, sonata posthume, but in fact he composed it when he was in the Paris Conservatoire. It's a single movement piece, very gentle and a fantastic nature.
Thank you.
So we are going to play another Ravel piece now, called In the Form of Habanera. This was originally a vocal piece, much later. Well, I think it's about 1907 he composed it. And but since he has transcribed it to cello and piano, it has become very popular among string players too. Followed by that, we'll play a couple of short pieces by Lily Boulanger. She was, a very talented composer. Unfortunately, not very much played due to her short life. She was only 24. And she passed away. Sister of a very renowned musician and pedagogue, Nadia Boulanger. And she composed Nocturne for flute, oboe, and Cortege, that is more fun piece, oboe. So we played three pieces all together.
Thank you. Attended previous concerts where we have used period instruments. This is another one of these events where you hear not a shiny black piano. You know, that's one of the things that's fascinated me, is the extent to which we must have our shiny black piano. And I have to admit that I have an affection for, well, it tells you my age, the satin black piano myself. The Satin Black Piano, of course, was the great Steinway and Baldwin concert grand, which is what I grew up admiring and wanting to play. But I have learned in my research that the shiny black piano didn't start till about 120 years ago. This is important research, you understand. And that actually, the piano of visual beauty with extraordinary wood finishes and lovely design, even if sometimes efficient and simple for the concert stage, preceded that and was much more popular prior to the shiny black piano. Now, it turns out that as I've researched the Chickering piano, which was the most important American piano before Steinway, the Chickering piano, even until 1910, 1915, 1920, didn't make black pianos. It made mahogany pianos for the concert stage. Why in the world is that important? Well, aesthetics is everything, isn't it? All of the different things that add up to the experience of music. So I just use the visual as an example because here you have an extraordinarily fine visual experience as well as everything that you came for. So the visual experience is something that I'm going to ask you to, at the end of the concert, come and look more closely at. Because this piano has marquetry. It has thousands of pieces of veneer inserted to create patterns of beauty. But this is a way of reaching back to the past, in a sense, reliving it, isn't it? Your program, we missed up on the date a little bit. It wasn't 186, it was 1869 that this piano was built, if you saw on the front of the program. The year 1869 actually wouldn't have been known because the logbooks for the London factory of Erard, and this is actually a French piano built in London, the logbooks of the London factory of Erard burned in a fire, so we don't know from any records when this piano was made. But it says so in the action on a key inside. So we know it was 1869. Reliving the past musically is something that we all do if we're musicians. But we're also trying to interpret the present. We're reliving the past, but we're also trying to take that music and experience it now and maybe even move it to the future. Reliving the past is yet something that we do trying to regain the ethos of the past, the aesthetic sensibility, the actual experience of living it. For example, I'll go into the museum exhibit room and just try to put candles on and listen to the piano. And that is an astounding, transportive experience. Is it silly? Some think that's a silly thing to do. But today we get to hear a sense of stepping back in time in a way that we rarely get to do because of the match of the music of France, French composers, and although this was built in London, a French designed and essentially French thought up piano. You can learn more about this piano if you go to our website at Period Piano Collection, and the website is periodpiano.org. And we have a page that talks about this piano. As a matter of fact, since the first page talks about this event, you can click right on the piano and go and learn a little more about the piano. What is different about this piano than a modern piano than what we've already talked about? This piano is very different and in some ways very much the same. It's so much the same that Period Piano Performance didn't include this at one point in time not too long ago as a historic instrument, but more just a modern piano. And Malcolm Beilson, sort of the papa of all period instrument performance in the United States, would have thought that 30 years ago, but he says something different today. And I think we should pay attention to the fact that he believes now that there are many different periods of pianos that we can go back to and better understand the music of the composers when we use those instruments to play and listen. So we have this here not just for you, but we want students to experience this before they get too far along in their practice as well. What are the big differences, though, with this piano? One, This is not an overstrung piano. Now, many of you may not know that grand pianos and upright pianos, for the last more than a century, have strings that cross each other. But that's the case. Except for these older instruments, they had flat stringing, or what we call straight stringing. And that actually affects the sound of the piano. The strings are shorter in the treble than on a modern piano. And that changes the aesthetic of the instrument. The soundboard is not designed to take a heavy load, but is very flat and has ribs that are oriented in a different way than in the modern piano. That has a real difference in the sound. I'd say that one of the big characteristics that are different than, say, the big Steinways in the storage room right now are that this piano has a little quicker decay. Now, unfortunately, this is kind of a bad example of that point, because this probably has the longest note decay of any Erard we have, and we have 9 Erard grands. This piano has the longest decay. That is, the tone lasts the longest of this piano, of all of them. But the idea is, with these period instruments, that there's more space between notes and more clarity. Now, if that's what the composer had in mind, and of course they didn't have any other choice but to use the instruments they had in their day, so that is what they had in mind, right? Then we can go back and better understand the music when we listen to it on the piano at the time. Erard was also interesting in that they invented two real important things that the modern piano has today. The modern piano action, the playing mechanism. Erard thought that up in 1821. Now, when his friend came up with a variation of it in the 1840s, and the world adopted it 40 years later, almost universally, Erard didn't. He liked the old idea better. So that's what we still have in this piano and all the other Erard pianos that were built up till after 1900, was his 1821 idea, essentially. And so it is a different action than the Steinway actions. And Valeria has to adjust or adapt to it, but then it gives an entirely different response aesthetically. And so you have a different action that's invented by Erard himself, but was the basis for the modern piano action later. Secondly, the way the string is fastened, or how it passes through with the termination in the front, is a special little hardware piece. And now I'm getting to the area that, of course, a piano tuner would be excited about, a piano technician like myself. Maybe you'd be less so. But that little device that actually holds the strings in place is on most all modern pianos today, too. The agraph, of course, a French word of God. So we can credit Erard with many things. But mostly, we thank Erard for having so successfully designed a piano that it was used for the music of everyone from Chopin through to Ravel. And so with that, I'd like to leave you to enjoy the next part of the concert and to come and take a look afterwards and see the beauty of the marquetry. And if you have questions, I'm here to answer. Thank you.
The next piece on the program, written by Mel or Melanie Boni, is a very beautiful, charming, melancholy, from the late Romantic period, written about 1903, actually, but not many people are aware of Melanie Boni, and I wasn't either until about a year or two ago, discovered that she had written a flute sonata. But with this trio, you'll find some very beautiful writing. Melanie Boni lived her life, I think she had plans, direct plans, how she wanted to lead her life, but things changed. And what I admire about her was as they changed, it wasn't a plan, how she still involved herself fully and with passion. When she was a young child, she was drawn to the piano at a very early age, though her parents were against her actually learning music, but she, on her own, would, without a teacher, learn the best she can. When she turned 12 with persuasion from friends and music professors. She was actually persuaded, and her parents relented for her to go to the Paris Conservatory, the premier music school in Paris. And there, she was classmates with, of all people, Claude Debussy. Apparently, they shared a bench together, piano duets. Her teacher was César Franck. But she, as many people do in college, found someone she fell in love with, though her parents were highly against this and withdrew her from the conservatory. They arranged for her to marry a man 22 years older. He had 5 children already. He was a 2-time widower. And then she devoted her life to domestic life, taking care of the children, and had 3 more children with him. He soon died afterwards, and the person she originally had fallen in love with, his wife, had passed, and they reunited, and he encouraged her to get back to resume her composition. Total, she wrote about 300 compositions. And the composer, the well-known composer Camille Saint-Saëns, said, of all things, today it would be very shocking to hear, but at the time he said, for a woman composer, she writes quite beautifully, and that's in her short biography. And she eventually became more well-known, and it's a joy to be able to share this music with you, with Valerie Penn, and with this wonderful piano. Instruments are tuned at A. The A would be at 440, 441, up to 443, possibly. This, if I remember correctly, is at A 437. So I've had to make adjustments by pulling out, but it seems to suit this very well. Thank you.
keep tuning my violin strings, because these are gut strings, which, unlike modern synthetic strings, it's very sensitive to temperature and moisture. So it just keep going out of tune. And that's the way it used to be. So the next piece we are going to play is the famous violin sonata by César Franck, the teacher of Melanie Bonny and many other people. This was composed in 1886, and he had actually planned for the violin sonata for many years, but not until this year that his longtime friend and fellow Belgian musician Eugène Ysaÿe got married, and on his occasion he composed this one and dedicated it to him. It is a grand sonata of four movements.
Thank you.
music after a long evening like this, but we want to throw in just one tiny piece by Debussy, A Girl with Flaxen Hair.